Ukraine is under fire. In today's webinar, we'll provide an overview of the most important cyber attacks the country has faced, both recently and further in the past. The examples we'll cover are not a comprehensive list of all the attacks we've seen and detected in the country. We're only focusing on nation-state level APT attacks, and even from those, just the most notable examples. I'm Robert Lipovsky, ESET's Principal Threat Intelligence Researcher. On February 24th, 2022, Russian military forces invaded Ukraine. On the cyber front, on the previous day, just a few hours, in fact, before the military aggression, we detected destructive wiper malware called Hermetic Wiper in a number of high-profile organizations in Ukraine. But before going into details, let's step back in time, because the country has been under heavy fire of cyber attacks for several years now. We've observed an increase in targeted attacks, in APT attacks, in the country since 2014. Now, we're not going to pretend that these cyber attacks and the geopolitical conflict in Ukraine are unrelated, but we need to make one thing clear. At ESET, we're not in a position to make attribution to nation states. That's the role of intelligence agencies. And we refrain from speculation. All of our findings are based on our detection telemetry, our malware analysis, and research. So when we attribute an attack, we attribute it to an APT group, an activity cluster, operation, or campaign. And here's a list of the most notable APT groups that have carried out targeted campaigns against Ukraine over the years. Again, it's not a comprehensive list. Let's take a closer look at perhaps the most infamous of these groups, Sandworm. In October 2020, the US Department of Justice released a public indictment of six hackers, and this way attributed Sandworm to the Russian GRU. By the way, in case you're wondering where the name Sandworm comes from, this is where the group got its name. In some of the early campaigns using malware called Black Energy, we discovered these text strings in the command and control addresses used by the malware. Apparently, the operators were fans of Frank Herbert's classic novel. And we've been tracking the activity of this APT group for many years now, and we've detected more and more campaigns against high-value targets in Ukraine since around the end of 2013. We've seen Black Energy attacks in Ukraine even in the years before that, like in 2012, but they really intensified from the end of 2013 and early 2014. Sandworm targeted all types of organizations, including government, diplomatic, media, transportation. And one of the main methods Sandworm used to infiltrate the target organizations was through carefully crafted, highly targeted spear phishing emails. Here is one example that actually used the war in Donbass as a lure. It reads, Arseniy Yatsenyuk, who was the prime minister at the time, instructed the prosecutor general's office, the security service of Ukraine, the Ministry of Internal Affairs, and the Ministry of Justice to check all members of parliament, parties, and NGOs in Ukraine for their involvement in the support of rebels in the east of Ukraine, and that in the attachment, there would be the list of these alleged terrorist supporters. So this is very good social engineering here. This was not your common Nigerian prince scam. As you can probably guess, in the background, malicious code was loaded. It would lead to the download and installation of Black Energy from a remote server. And it's important to note that here the attackers exploited a zero-day vulnerability in PowerPoint, which we reported to Microsoft in 2014. In terms of functionality, Black Energy was a multifunctional modular espionage malware. Here are some of the plugins we've seen being deployed over those years. Some were used for lateral movement across the network. Others were for stealing information from the victims. So Black Energy was used in many campaigns against many organizations in Ukraine, but the most notable attack was against the Ukrainian power grid. This attack, facilitated by the Black Energy malware, was carried out in a coordinated manner against at least four electric distribution companies in various regions of the country, so-called Obloenergos. The attackers then misused remote access connections to manually switch off the flow of electricity, and as a result, the homes of around 250,000 Ukrainians across the nation went dark for up to 6 hours. That was the first mass power outage caused by a cyber attack, but the attackers didn't stop there. Almost exactly 1 year later, in December 2016, there was another blackout, again caused by a cyber attack, and this time the attackers really stepped up their game. They used malware, which upon our discovery we named it Indestroyer, and there were quite a few differences from the attack the year before. In 2016, we know of only one electricity substation being hit, but a large one, Kiev North Transmission Substation. And the malware they used, Indestroyer, unlike with Black Energy before, Indestroyer was the first ever malware specifically designed to attack power grids. What I mean by that is that it was going after these types of devices. These are protection relays, industrial hardware, and Indestroyer spoke the language of this hardware. So it contained implementation of not one, but four different industrial communication protocols. And it would send commands to these protection relays. This was malware unlike any that we've seen before in terms of sophistication, I guess second only to Stuxnet. And it's, if you think about it, it's not just about the coding, about writing the malware, but the attackers had to do their prior research. They needed to understand the inner workings of the systems, the architecture of an electrical substation, what commands to send, and what would be achieved as a result of sending those commands. So what was their goal? It was to cause a power outage. Electrical terms, to cause a de-energization of the substation. But we also discovered clues in the industry configuration that suggest they wanted to go further than that, that they wanted to cause equipment damage, equipment malfunction as well, and then also through a data wiper module to make recovery from this event more difficult. In this case, though, the blackout lasted only for about 1 hour, and I'd say a rather disappointing result for such sophisticated malware. In the following years, there was a lot of evolution of the toolset used by Sandworm. The group split its activities. There was the Gray Energy Cluster, which continued attacks against the energy sector, and Telebots, which carried out attacks mainly against the financial sector in Ukraine. Telebots was also behind the infamous NotPetya outbreak in June 2017. This disruptive FAW ransomware, and by FAW ransomware I mean that it was ransomware, it did encrypt files, but it didn't do it for financial gain, that was just for cover. Its goal was disruption. And the disruption was enormous. It was around the whole country, and as a result, As you can see, for example, in this photo taken here, people couldn't buy gas at gas stations, people couldn't pay at point-of-sales terminals, in supermarkets. So how did the malware accomplish this? What was so special about NotPetya? It seemed to attack businesses at random, no matter the size or the industry. And the key lies in its initial vector, or what we call the patient zero, if you want. And ESET researchers were actually the first to discover this initial vector. The compromise spread from a small software company called EmiDoc. It was small, but it was influential, as it was the provider of a very popular accounting software used by the majority of companies in Ukraine. Some estimates go as high as 80% of businesses in Ukraine using this financial software. And, well, size and popularity seem to be part of the reason why attackers chose MEDOC as their initial target. It was deeply ingrained in the supply chain with ties to a large number of companies, but at the same time, it was vulnerable, making it an ideal target to compromise and then later misuse to distribute a malicious update that would then send the whole Ukrainian economy to its knees. And soon, it even surpassed the Ukrainian borders, even affecting the global supply chain. After a few hours, its destructive potential was felt in the region and also globally. This was because NotPetya propagated as a network worm using the Eternal Blue exploit, and many global companies had branches and network connections to Ukraine. So they got infected. We believe that NotPetya was primarily aimed at Ukrainian businesses and that the compromises beyond Ukraine's borders were reckless collateral damage. Still, even today, NotPetya is considered the most devastating cyber attack in history. The damages caused by this pseudo-ransomware, this pretend ransomware, added up to over $10 billion, and that number is probably just the tip of the iceberg and a sum of the reported damages by the largest victims, such as transportation giants like Maersk or FedEx, Russian oil corporation Rosneft, or US-based pharmaceutical company Merck. In Ukraine, the disruption was so great that the end of the tax year had to be postponed so the companies could catch up on their accounting. Although the most notable, the most visible attacks by Sandworm happened between 2015 and 2017, the important thing to keep in mind is that the group is still active. Okay, so let's take a look at another group, also a very infamous one, known for also its attacks against Western targets, against NATO targets, against high-profile targets around the world. But that also has been targeting Ukraine, and that's what we call SEDNIT, also known as Fancy Bear or APT-28. So they conducted a number of targeted operations in Ukraine over the years, and this group even deployed LoJacks, what was our discovery of the first UFI rootkit found in the wild. So this really shows the technical level, the technical sophistication of this group. And they managed to deploy this UFI rootkit in order to establish the highest level and the most resilient type of persistence, because once they infected the UFI of their victims through this, it would resist even to system reinstallation or even a hard drive swap. Other APT groups active in Ukraine are Gamma Radon and Invisible. We actually track them as separate groups since they both run their own campaigns, but we've seen a few cases where they cooperated. And there's a big difference in how these two groups operate. Gamma Radon has been the most active APT group in Ukraine in the recent years. So these are high-volume attacks, and they are simply brute force. Their malware is in constant development, and we detect new versions all the time. And this is in stark contrast with the highly covert modus operandi that we saw in the case of Invisible Group. Let me show you an example of the rare strategic cooperation between the two. So first, the Gamma Radon group focuses on breaching the target organizations and choosing the most interesting targets. Here's a typical scenario. Gamma Radon uses spear phishing emails as the initial vector, This email has a malicious document in the attachment, a decoy document with a malicious macro. When this document is opened and macros are allowed, aided with social engineering, it silently launches a VBS downloader, which then downloads the gamma rhythm payload we detect as Pterodo. And once in there, it performs reconnaissance in all of the networks and identifies the most interesting targets. Afterwards, the reins are passed over to Invisimo, which focuses on espionage. And only a small number of targets are then upgraded to this more elaborate Invisimo malware, and probably those considered by the attackers as particularly interesting. We have seen high-profile organizations such as government and diplomatic targeted by these groups. And as I said, there are many, many more APT groups conducting attacks against Ukraine that we won't have time to go into today. But we have been releasing our findings on them both in our private threat intelligence reports and also in our We Live Security blog posts. Let's now take a look at the most recent events. On the night between January 13th and January 14th, a wiper masqueraded as ransomware was used in Ukraine. This was called Whispergate. Then, on the 23rd of February, so this is the day before the Russian military invasion, there was a series of distributed denial of service attacks. Their operations targeted several important websites in Ukraine, mostly banks and government institutions, including the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Ministry of Defense, the Ministry of Internal Affairs, the Security Service, SBU, and the Cabinet of Ministers. Then, just a few hours later, we discovered another far more destructive attack targeting computers in Ukraine. The attack with malware we now call Hermetic Wiper started just before 5 p.m. Ukrainian local time, so it preceded the Russian military invasion by just a few hours. We stayed up late analyzing the malware and published our discovery on Twitter, not knowing what would happen the next morning. We found Hermetic Wiper on hundreds of systems in at least 5 Ukrainian organizations. It was trying to corrupt their data and render these machines unbootable, and therefore any public-facing services they might have been running inaccessible. On a technical level, it would override the master boot record, the master file table, files containing registry keys, and also wiping several other locations on the hard drive with random bytes. It also disabled volume shadow copy service to hinder recovery efforts by defenders. The timestamp of the Hermetic Wiper executable shows it was compiled on December 28th, 2021, unless it was tampered with, of course. So that, along with some other indicators, shows that the attackers have planned this attack months ahead of time and were also in the affected systems for some time. Hermetic Wiper wasn't the only malicious code used in this destructive campaign. A second piece of malware that was used is Hermetic Wizard, a worm that tries to find other reachable machines on the local network and used to deploy Hermetic Wiper across the local network. So to do so, it would use WMI and SMB spreaders. And the third piece of malware was ransomware named Hermetic Ransom. It was written in the Go language and deployed at the same time as Hermetic Wiper. Now, the use of Hermetic Ransom is a bit strange. I mean, why run ransomware when you've wiped the machine? perhaps to hide the wiper's actions. But what's interesting is that the combination of these three pieces of malware effectively does something similar to what NotPetya did. Even the SMB spreader in Hermetic Wizard was named Romance DLL, perhaps a reference to the Eternal Romance or Eternal Blue exploits, although in this case, no exploits were actually used. Do note that these are high-level similarities. We did not see similarities on a low level in the code. Here is the ransom message displayed by Hermetic Ransom after encrypting the victim's files. But just as in the NotPetya case, we don't think this was financially motivated. The attackers also left a few strings in the binary, mostly referencing US President Joe Biden and the White House. Hermetic Wiper and Hermetic Wizard are signed by a code signing certificate assigned to Hermetica Digital, and the certificate was issued on April 13th, 2021. And this is where the malware got its name from. We requested the issuing certificate authority, DigiCert, to revoke the certificate, which it did on February 24th, 2022. According to a report by Reuters, it seems that this certificate wasn't stolen from Hermetica Digital, but it was rather that the attackers impersonated the Cypriot company in order to get this certificate from DigiCert. Soon after, we identified another wiper deployed in Ukraine, Isaac Wiper. Isaac Wiper wipes the first bytes of each hard drive it finds using the Mersenne Twister pseudorandom generator. It then enumerates the logical drives and recursively wipes every file of every disk with random bytes. It wipes the files in a single thread. So it would take a really long time to wipe a large drive. So unlike Hermetic Wiper, Isaac Wiper was very unsophisticated malware. Isaac Wiper was first deployed on February 24th, the day of the Russian military invasion. And the oldest compilation timestamp ESET found is October 19th, 2021. Again, this shows that if the compilation timestamp wasn't tampered with, that Isaac Wiper was created months before February this year and might have even been used in some previous cyber attacks. At this point, there are still several things that we simply don't know. Although Isaac Wiper and Hermetic Wiper were deployed around the same time, there are no other links connecting them. The initial vector used to deliver Isaac Wiper and those hermetic threats is also unknown. What we do know, however, is that attackers were already inside the networks before deploying this. In one case, Hermetic Wiper was deployed through a group policy rule, which suggests the attackers had compromised the Active Directory server. The Hermetic malware doesn't share any significant code similarity with any other samples in our malware collection. And we have also not found any tangible connection with any of the threat actors that we track. Not with Sandworm, not with any other group. So let's wrap up and recap what the main objectives of the attackers were in the attacks against Ukraine. The first objective was espionage or data collection. We've seen this being done through various types of functionality like stealing files, keylogging, taking screenshots, and then sending these over to command and control servers controlled by the attackers. And then in a number of cases, we've also seen objectives of sabotage or simply signaling. So these were carried out through disruptive components, and we've also seen an evolution. We've seen these disruptive components in many different flavors, so to speak. So there were some disruptive black energy plugins. There were various variants of malware we call Killdisk. Again, a wiper, basically. We've seen NotPetya and also other far ransomware. And then most recently, Hermetic Wiper, Isaac Wiper, and even other wipers like Desert Blade. As I mentioned, we only scratched the surface in this presentation. Ukraine was under heavy fire in terms of cyber attacks for the past 8 years. So what's next? We believe that attacks are certainly going to continue. We will be on the lookout. On the other hand, now that the war has become full-on kinetic, I don't think that there's going to be a dramatic increase of APT-level cyber attacks. So yes, we do expect them to continue, but not increase dramatically. This webinar focused on Ukraine, but many of the groups that we've discussed, and even those that we haven't gone into great detail, have been targeting other countries as well. So users, defenders, IT admins, security operations center analysts need to stay alert. At ESET, we continue monitoring the attacker's activity in order to provide protection both within our endpoint security solutions as well as providing actionable threat intelligence in our private reports. For your daily portion of ESET research, make sure to visit our website, welivesecurity.com, and follow our Twitter account at ESET Research. Thank you for listening, and stay safe.